be the only one dancing again while you're.
You can dance if you want. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think yeah, so a bit of backing dancers might add a bit to the atmosphere. Yeah.
But I think the Netherlands is a very liberal country, like
Oh, yes. Yes, I do.
So then we have to make sure that it goes over the HMI port.
Yeah, it's,
otherwise, we won't hear it.
Let's make sure of. Okay.
Already streaming.
All right. Okay.
And then I get copyright violation.
Okay. Oh, I don't have any copyright. No, I don't think I have any copyrighted music in. Yeah.
Can you go start if you want, I think.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so hello everyone. I'm Matt, and this is the story of how I ended up doing Spectrum development for a major TV show in 2018, which is kind of odd for Spectrum development. So first of all, just a note, there are sort of minor Bandersnatch, Black Mirror spoilers in this. I'll try not to sort of give away this sort of too much, but yeah. So, yeah, as you've probably gathered from sort of previous days here, I'm very much sort of ZX Spectrum obsessive, the old home computer from the 1980s, particularly begin the UK, and also, yeah, to some extent, the rest of Europe too. And my particular main angle on this is through the demo scene. For those of you who haven't encountered the demo scene, it's an international community of hackers, graphic artists, and musicians who are producing these real-time video art pieces. They're kind of in a similar format to like music videos, but with the visuals all generated in real time. And these things, the creativity of it is very much driven by the programmers and exploring what they can do under their chosen constraints, which might be anything from like the top of the range PCs and seeing how you can push the top end graphics card to the limits. Or seeing how much you can do in like 4 kilobytes of code, or right down to sort of where my particular interest is in creating these sort of visual effects and things on the retro computers like the Spectrum. And beyond the demo scene, I've kind of branched out into sort of other bits of, still in the general theme of just showing off with the Spectrum. I did a music video for a local band that runs on the Spectrum. There's also, this is the on the right, this is a project I did with the Museum of the History of Science in Oxford, where we networked, I think it was 10 or 12 Spectrums together to make an orchestra that would play Mahler's First Symphony. And yeah, in a tribute to the, there was an exercise in the Spectrum manual that showed you how to play the, use the beep command. It says, no, use this to sort of play the whole of Mahler's First Symphony. And for EMF last year, I created this giant sort of bouncy castle version of a Spectrum, which was actually inspired by a comment at Shah the year before, which was when I did a presentation on doing chiptunes on the Spectrum, and Jenny tweeted, "I've never seen a Spectrum screen this large." It's, well, maybe we should have a giant Spectrum to go with that as well. Yeah, quite possibly, yep. And, of course, if you were around last night, you'll know that I have my alter ego as the world's number one ZX Spectrum rock star. And so it's through these general exploits I've kind of built up over time this kind of extensive social circle that know me as that Spectrum guy. And it's through that that's occasionally spun off into sort of opportunities like this one. So this is Chris Milroy, otherwise known as C-Trix, is an amazing chiptune musician on Game Boy and sort of Sega and Nintendo, all sorts. And he sort of got in touch because this was through a friend of a friend who's been contacted by this producer for a TV show that you'll have definitely heard of, and they were looking for some Spectrum code to be done for that. So, yep, I said that it sounds like something I'd be up for. So he put me in touch with Russell McLean, who's one of the producers of Black Mirror. Incidentally, I don't know exactly how he ended up through this particular sort of chain of contacts, and because apparently this friend of a friend was just contacted out of the blue. So it's, but yeah, it ended up the hot potato in my hands. So on the off chance that anyone's unfamiliar with Black Mirror, it's this science fiction drama series. It's taking this really dark tone, exploring like the near future implications of today's technology, and what the outcome would be if things go a bit too far. I think there's been a joking suggestion that the synopsis of every episode of Black Mirror is "What if phones, but too much?" So yeah, I think that kind of works. So I signed the NDA, and because obviously the actual production details of this, it's a sort of closely guarded secret. But so he told me the general gist of things, that this was going to be, they're doing an episode about a ZX Spectrum games programmer in the 80s, and they wanted some real-world sort of Spectrum programs to tie into that. Again, I was only really given the absolute essential of bits of information about this episode, and one thing that I notably didn't get told was the fact that this was an interactive episode. So it's on Netflix, and this is one, the gimmick of this episode was that every now and then it would sort of stop and give you one of these choices, choose the left or right thing, and then it would be a kind of choose your own adventure style. You get to decide the outcome. But I did at least find out the name of the episode, which was Bandersnatch, and this is sort of a name that's particularly significant to sort of Spectrum aficionados, because there was this infamous bit of real-world Spectrum vaporware called Bandersnatch back in 1984. This software house, Imagine, they decided that they were going to stand out from the crowd by creating these so-called mega games that would have this bit of hardware expansion in the package that would sort of expand your Spectrum's new sort of unseen capabilities. And I think they just started buying into their own hype too much, and so none of the software distributors had any idea what to make of this. So they crashed and burned in spectacular style, and interestingly, it was all caught on video for a BBC documentary that was meant to be this sort of glowing report of this new growing industry of the British software industry, and then they ended up getting a documentary that went in not quite the direction they expected. And obviously, this is really Charlie Brooker's bread and butter. It seems like he's a bit of a retro computer nerd. He actually started out as a games journalist, and this is an Easter egg, because Black Mirror is very big on this blink and you miss it Easter eggs. So this is from a previous episode, Playtest, which has actually mentions Cyclops and Bandersnatch, which are the two mega games on the Spectrum and the C64, and Minor Willy Meets the Taxman, which is another sort of famous unreleased game on the Spectrum. You get the sense that Charlie Brooker is kind of really passionate about this, about the old computers, and this then doing an episode about Spectrum games programmers was kind of probably a bit of a passion project for him. I discovered this quite recently. There's a radio show in the UK called Desert Island Discs, where they sort of invite sort of celebrities on and interview them, and they get to choose their the eight songs that they would sort of take to listen to on a desert island. And one of his choices was the title music to the Game Boy version of RoboCop. So yeah, he's one of us. So I was given the basic outline of the episode, and what they wanted me to do was related to this scene here, where it's towards the beginning of the show. There's this scene where he's going off to the software house, Tuckersoft, to show off his work and maybe he'll get hired there. And there's a callback to this as a post-credit scene, where rather than sort of listening to music on his Walkman, you get this. See at the right window. Lost my tabs. Yeah. So you get this scene where this happens. You might want to sort of turn the order down a bit, yeah. So, understandably, this confused quite a few viewers who encountered this scene here. And the quirk of the fact that this was this episode was released at midnight somewhere in the US time. And when the fan forums that I read it first encountered this, as people were not really sure what to make of this, they said, "I've heard these funny noises. It sounds like it might be like slow scan TV or something." And then it got sort of a bit of a back and forth of people saying, "Oh, you youngsters, don't you recognise that? That's clearly modem noise." Okay, a nice try at being an old fart, but maybe try like a decade earlier. And it's because it sort of dropped at midnight US time, that meant that the first people who sort of saw this episode would have been the people who'd stayed up past midnight in the US. And because the spectrum wasn't really a big thing over there, it was this was probably a bit baffling there. It was only when the European audience woke up and saw it that people started to figure out what was going on here. Although, when I'd have mentioned this fact on Twitter, I did get some sort of angry Americans saying, "How dare you? I'll have you know, I'm aware of old computers that use tapes for storage." So okay, yeah, I'll revise that my statement there too. I think it's the fact that the spectrum it was probably the one platform where you actually routinely heard that, because rather than this being just something that people who listened to tapes for fun would encounter, this is something that you would routinely hear as you are loading games and waiting the 5 minutes for it to load. And instantly. I think that there is a theory that that is actually a design fault of the Spectrum, that really it was just the loading, the stripes on the border was what was meant to indicate the fact that it was loading, and it was just the fact that internally the hardware port that deals with the border also deals with the audio speaker as well, so it unintentionally pipes these screeching sounds through the Spectrum speaker as well. But this is it's something that the European audience at least made sense of, and so people so have got this audio and started loading it up into the Spectrum. And initially, the request that they came to me with was they just wanted a program that would print up a QR code that when you scanned it, it would take you to a secret website. And I thought, well, I can do that, but it seems a bit on the boring side. And given that I've got this background in doing like visual effects and things, then for an increased fee, I could do some sort of fancy sort of glitching animations and things. And I'm happy to say that spot of upselling did work on them. So this is I'll fire up on an emulator what this actually did. Just make sure I've got the fast loading down. Oops, I'll get that back. So that's a little quirk I was quite proud of. Usually file names are restricted to 10 characters, but a basic keyword also counts as a character, so and at, you can actually spell out Bandersnatch. And I did this little thing with the adding like VHS style glitches and sort of bits of interference and things. And I like to think this enhances the whole general Black Mirror ambiance. And goes through a few little tricks. And, there's quite a bit of looking through YouTube clips of the VHS noise that people have created, and it's one of these things. It's kind of like the whole like a swan on the surface is just very graceful, but it's flapping like mad, and these things that they look like it's just. I've corrupted a few bytes and it's sort of behaving a bit weirdly. So you get, but instead there's a lot of trickery going into it. So things like the little ripple that you get at the base there, that's actually storing like 8 different copies of the QR code and like picking the right one for each line. And conversely, I think there's also bits that are like this bit here, which looks fancier than it actually is. That's just really saying, okay, instead of drawing this as a 20-character wide sprite, pretend it's 21 characters wide, and then the effect of the weird screen layout on the Spectrum means it just ends up glitching out in that particular way. Okay, so. I'll shut that down. That was kind of the first assignment was to create that QR code, and I think they gave me a lot of freedom. I think the only real sort of constraint was that, well, whatever you do, it absolutely has to come in at 60 seconds. It can't be any longer than that. And yeah, no problem. So that was having done this program to bring you to the website, secret website, the next step was obviously to have some content on the website, and that came in the form of I was tasked with creating an actual Spectrum version of one of the games that appears in the show. So I'll show you the particular clip where this comes up. My tab's right again. So it was. Oops.
playing.
No, that's not good. Oh, just a beach ball of doom. Okay, let's. Okay, let's try this again.
Called nosedive.
Sprites are so smooth.
That took some doing. Oh, bollocks.
So the games, everything that you see on the Spectrum screens in the show itself was actually all done so before I was brought on board. This was all done as kind of a video, done in like Adobe Premiere or whatever the tool of choice was. And I think it has to be said that they did a pretty good job of recreating the sort of Spectrum quirks, considering this was entirely sort of faked. The Spectrum has this famous quirk of color clash, where because you can only have within each of 8x8 pixel square, you can only have two colors, like a foreground and a background. So if you have sort of several sort of sprites moving on top of each other, it has to pick one color. So they sort of dutifully faked all of this stuff in their video editing package. So you can see at this point where he's sort of crashing into one of the eyeballs, it's turning him green as well. And as that one is going above the high score text, that's sort of changing as well. So it's done a decent job of this. And there's just a couple of sort of little sort of annoyances, like the little yellow details on the walls, which you can't really do because you got the yellow a bit too close to the purple and the red and also the fact he's got a blue hat. That would not have happened in a real Spectrum game, so had to adapt things slightly. But as I say, they've done sort of a really good job of this, and that really sort of made my job a lot easier of creating a version of this game, because pretty much all the design was done for me. There's a couple of different games that get that appear in the show, and they showed me these clips of all of them. There's the really nice one was Metalhead, which is shown right. This is supposedly their star programmer's previous hit. And it's also a reference to a previous episode of Black Mirror. It's all about their Easter eggs, and it does look really lovely. All this parallax scrolling, and I would have loved to actually make this game, but I just thought, I'm not sure if I've actually seen a real Spectrum game do that kind of level of scrolling. So I didn't think I could really risk sort of saying, sure, I'll have a go at that, and then having to come back to them a month later saying, oh, actually, no, that's impossible. And they also gave me the clips of the Bandersnatch itself, the game that this episode is all about. And but I didn't really get any context of what these things actually meant, so I kind of missed out on the detail that is that playing again? Yeah. That as you actually progress through this game, then and you sort of encounter the enemies, then it will give you the little choice bars that mirror what happens in the actual episode. So I didn't get any of this nuance. I just thought, okay, that's it's some sort of maze game, and it's got enemies. Oh, okay, I guess I can do something that fits that. But yeah, if I'd known at this point what this game actually calls for in the plot of the episode, it would have been no, I'm not touching that with the barge pole. But luckily they didn't go for that one in the end. So they just went for creating this the nosedive game. So let's quickly get that one up. I'll spare the slow tape loading process. So yeah, hopefully it's fairly authentic to the how it appears in the show. The only real sort of decision I had beyond what was in the video was how the controls would work. So I decided to try and go for this whole Flappy Bird thing of making the control the keyboard controls a bit quirky and hard to get to grips with. So if you don't press any key, it will sort of drift left and right. But I think my high score in this game is pretty good because I had to do all the testing to make sure that the score rolled out over into the thousands. But although I think that might have been on a version of the game before I tweaked the difficulty a bit. But yeah, that's managed to infuriate quite a lot of people. So yeah, mission accomplished. And considering that games and the code that you see as part of the show itself was done to by the production team, and I had nothing to do with this. And so in some respects, it's a bit inauthentic. So you get these freeze frames where you can see the code they've written, and yeah, it's written in BASIC, which definitely would not be the case for a game back in the day. But relative to your typical movie hacking scenes, I have to say that they did a pretty good job, because yeah, it wouldn't be in BASIC, but this is actually a genuine ZX Spectrum BASIC listing, and I think if you type this listing in, you actually do get something that is a vague approximation to the actual game. You get the eyeballs actually scrolling up the screen, sort of a character at the time. So I have to sort of take my hat off to them, and I think that was the influence of Charlie Brooker again. I saw this interview with the Wired that he did, where it sounds like he was kind of acting the role of the pedant throughout this whole process. Like, yeah, the number of conversations we've fucking had about Spectrum games and the sound of Spectrum makes, and it wouldn't make a sound like that if you're pressing that button there. So having gone through all this sort of internal nitpicking of that colour clash isn't quite right, and now hearing that Charlie Brooker was just the same, that did make me rather happy. Obviously, the process of creating this in sort of 2018 is very different to the enduring the rubber keyboard of the like they would have done back in the day. I was working entirely on emulators and cross compiling with like command line tools. So it's just like a single line command that would like take all the graphic assets and package that up into the executable. And incidentally, making the sprites really smooth, as he says in the episode, was actually the bit that took some doing. It's the thing about the Spectrum is that you don't really have enough processor time to sort of create the whole next frame of animation in a back buffer and then push it all to the screen in one go. So when you're clearing and redrawing sprites, you've got to you've got to be aware of the fact that if you're clearing the sprite while the refresh of the screen reaches that point, then you're going to get a bit of flicker there. And so I was determined not to make that happen. So I hadn't actually seen that scene, the scene of him saying, yeah, the sprites are really smooth at the point that I did this, but obviously I'm glad it worked out that way. So yeah, I ended up doing various fancy sprite routines that did the clearing and redrawing at the same point, and then having to have about 4 or 5 different copies of this routine for all the different sprite widths. So lots of faff, but yeah, definitely worth the effort. But yeah, I didn't really know the context of where these would fit in from the episode. All I had to really go on was these 20-second clips of the gameplay itself. So when the show did finally get released, I kind of got the reveals in the back to front order. So this is one of the the graphic assets that they sent over was that, so it's the main sprite. You'll notice that it has the file name Colin001. And I thought, okay, Colin, that's just the name of the character in the game. And I didn't realise that Colin is, in fact, in the episode, the name for the programmer who made this game. And there's obviously being the episode is all about sort of breaking the fourth wall. And so that means that logically Colin is actually me. And then sort of the game is actually foreshadowing sort of this, him taking a leap off a building himself. So logically that means that I'm... Yep. So meanwhile, there's endings where Stefan, the other programmer, cracks from the stress of making the game and starts killing the people who are checking up on him. And as it happens, I was like a week or two late delivering this. So I think I can only imagine when Russell, the producer, was emailing me, "How's it doing? Oh, I just need a couple more days." I don't know what he thought I was up to. So it's. So he must have been rather more stressed than I was. So So on the subject of Easter eggs, I hadn't really sort of realised to what extent how fervent the Black Mirror fans were at sort of seeking out these Easter eggs. And obviously, this whole project that I was involved in was basically one hell of an elaborate Easter egg, and it got to, figured out within 24 hours. But I think there was this sense of, well, if the rabbit hole has gone this far, there surely must be some more to it than that. And in particular, I think that a lot of people hung up on the fact that at one point in the show, he has to sort of dial like a number to call his therapist, and they're thinking, oh, surely there must be other numbers that you can type in to reveal other secrets. And wait a minute, the score of this game, it's a 5-digit number, so there must be something to do with if I score a particular amount in this game, then something will happen. And so there were people just trying to get up to sort of 99990 with cheats. And I think, given that the whole production of the game was kind of so late in the production process, I think the idea that they would have somehow engineered an Easter egg in the game that would then feed back into the show itself, I think that would have been some sort of next level genius master plan thing. So, I'm afraid that if there are any Easter eggs at that level, then I'm not involved in them. But I did inadvertently fuel a bit more Easter egg speculation, because at the point where I did the QR code, I wasn't actually sure if I was going to get a credit of my own in either in the show or otherwise. So and it wasn't sort of confirmed that I would be actually working on the game itself at that point. Obviously, the QR code bit had priority because that was forming part of the episode itself, and they had to sort of get that into the sound the sound mix that then got sent off to Netflix. As a kind of an insurance policy, so that when I was at occasions like this where I'd be coming up saying, yes, this is the thing I did, I needed to be able to prove that it was me. And I wasn't really sure, whether I'd be able to... what I could get away with putting into secret credits without sort of breaking immersion. Because, maybe it's sort of essential that it all stays in universe. So I decided that the best way to go about that was I sort of added this little message in the binary of the QR code program saying sort of bigger digger, bigger bee. Which those of you who were paying attention last night will remember I played the Sandstorm by Darude with the bigger digger bigger bee lyrics, and I thought, okay, this is a phrase that's related to me, and but it's not Googleable at this point, so I think that's avoiding sort of leaking my identity out to anyone who's not in the know. But obviously the Easter egg hunters have then discovered this, and there was wild speculation of, oh, it must be this episode to this other episode that had mechanical bees in it. And so, I think I sort of led people up the garden path on that one. That's kind of about the end of my story. I think there was one just epilogue, which is the last bit of life in this thing, which is that just after the episode was aired, there was these pop-up shops around the UK. I think there's one sort of in London around Old Street and one in Birmingham New Street Station, of these Tucker Soft branded news agents. And there was this signing event that happened in the London one, and they had my game being played in the background there. So unfortunately, I've did all of this entirely remotely, so I didn't really get to sort of meet Charlie Brooker or any of the cast. But at least I can now console myself with the fact that my game has been in the presence of Charlie Brooker. So I think that's a success in that. Thanks very much. Any questions? Microphone.
Hello. Yeah. I seem to remember at one point you mentioned there might have been something else. Was there, or was that just you leading us up the garden path?
What I said was truthful. I don't really want to get anyone's hopes up.
Okay.
I just certainly didn't do anything on the scale of like another game that I'm not telling anyone about. But there was kind of another bit of material related to this that they asked for. I'm obviously being sort of vague in case this is kind of the one remaining bit of insider information that I'm not allowed to reveal yet. But I don't know if they've sort of made use of this or whether this was kind of an idea that didn't come to pass. But I'll hold on to
we'll
that.
We'll just have to wait then, I guess.
Yeah.
Questions?
Okay.
In that case, thank you.
Okay.